appreciate you having me on here. And it's really good of you to seek out a professional to help out your niche, your industry, the moving industry. There's a lot of potential on Facebook that moving companies, businesses in general, they're missing out on. And the barrier to entry is really low. There's a couple key things that you have to know to be able to build out a Facebook campaign. And it's a lot of how-to stuff, right? So I want to show that. I want to show you all, like, okay, from start to finish, as plainly as possible, how do you build a Facebook campaign properly? And I see this all the time. There's a couple things that you can do inside Facebook. Facebook doesn't really tell you, and they just kind of eat your money, right? Mm-hmm. Because you don't set the things up the way to maximize your return. Okay. Mm-hmm. I want to show that. I want to show how to set everything up from scratch. And then I want to go into targeting. And then we're going to go into like who we're targeting, because that's going to be a big thing for moving companies. Is you have a lot of potential different customers. We were talking earlier about, you know, two types of customers. I believe you were saying you have the people who are forced into moving, mm-hmm. right? And then you have the people who want a moving company, right? Like me, like I hate moving, right? And I feel like my feelings on moving is pretty regular out in the world, right? Mm-hmm. So, and just those two dynamics is like, it's like a category, and then you have subcategories within those. So like the forced one we were talking about, you have people who just, they're physically not able to move, right?
Yeah.
Maybe they're retired or they're a little bit older and you know, that would be stressful. Or maybe in the forced category is a professional, right? Those are different ads. And instead of having like a radio ad, which is the shotgun approach, mm-hmm. right? So we just blast out on the radio, hey, we're a moving company. This is what we provide, mm-hmm. all that different stuff. And then hopefully within all the demographic of who you're talking to, your message resonates with someone, right? The shotgun approach, okay? With Facebook, what we're able to do is we're able to be like a sniper rifle, right? We can hone in on who we're targeting or on who we're talking to, and we can write an ad or a message just for that person, right? Instead of trying to talk to everyone, we can talk to a specific demographic of person, right? Mm-hmm. And maybe an older, we'll get into that part. But just know that there's a lot of potential on Facebook. It's not that hard to do once you know a little bit of the how-to stuff, which I'm going to get into. And then I want to talk about a little bit as we go through a little bit of the mindset, the how to think about your marketing. So we'll talk about budgets. We'll talk about, you know, what you should be spending, things like that.
Awesome.
Cool.
Cool. All right. Let's run it.
Let's do it. All right, I'm going to share my screen here. Let me move you over here so I can see everything here. All right. So as you can see here, you have just a quick rundown of this. I am in business manager. One of the biggest problems that I see people do, Winston, one of the biggest issues that I see is people run ads from their Facebook page, right? Mm-hmm. That's problem number one. All right, and typically what they end up doing is boosting posts. Right. So inside, so if we create a campaign, I'm going to go to create here. I'm in business manager, business.facebook.com, business.facebook.com. If you are going to run ads on Facebook, that's where you need to go. It is a third platform of Facebook. It's the way to think of it, that connects to your page. But what it does is it opens up everything inside of Facebook. With all the different, there's more things in there than you'll ever look at or use, but it opens everything up, all your targeting options, everything, okay? So I'm gonna click create. And when we create a campaign in here, you can see all the different campaign objectives. This is like saying, hey, Facebook, I want you to go find me people who are most likely to do X, X being what our objective that we choose is. Does that make sense, Winston?
Yeah.
So traffic. So this is saying, hey, Facebook, go find me people who are most likely to click my ad. Okay. That's traffic. People who are going to click your ad. engagement. This is saying, by the way, this is a boosted post. If most of your people who have run ads on Facebook probably have boosted a post. This is a post. And this right here is why most people don't get what it is. They don't get the outcome that they're looking for because they're telling Facebook to do the wrong thing. Okay. Yeah. So an engagement ad is saying, hey, Facebook, I want you to show my ad to people who are most likely to like, comment, or share my ad. And those are all cool things. But the reality is, I can't put likes and clicks and shares in my pocket or in my bank account, but I can put leads in my bank account. Mm-hmm. And that's what we want, right? We want traffic to a page, a page where we can collect their information. We give them an offer. And we want to tell Facebook, this is what I want. I want leads. So we want conversions. I'm not going to go into all these messages. You get the point. To Facebook, hey, Facebook, give me people, so show my ad to people who are most likely to start a conversation in Facebook Messenger. Hey, Facebook, show my ad to people who are most likely to watch at least 15 seconds or more of my video, right? Mm-hmm. The two that local businesses need to focus on are these two right here, traffic and conversions. And you can use either one. Traffic is, give me clicks, Facebook. Give me some clicks, right, to my website or my landing page, okay? Or conversions. Same idea. Inside Facebook, this is the better one in my opinion. Inside Facebook, you have different types of conversions. A conversion could be a lead, which is what I'm going to recommend everybody goes to. You have other conversions such as scheduled appointments. Let me cancel this real quick. You can see I'm optimizing conversions for leads, okay? And that's just one of the things you get to select. I could also optimize for appointments, okay? Getting somebody to schedule with me.
Right.
Okay. Hey, listen, I'm going to kind of give a high level of this. If you want to stop and talk about something, you just stop me, okay?
Otherwise, yeah, I'm going to keep going. So for folks, these appointments that he's talking about, that would be your on-site or over the phone estimate. Okay. That's what we'd be wanting to get scheduled for. Cause that's where we're going to get an opportunity to talk on the phone or talk in person, get something set up where we can present some numbers to somebody for our service.
Gosh. So would somebody schedule that appointment or you get a lead, you would call it?
You could go either way. Most of the time we're going to call them or they're going to call us. We're going to schedule that estimate over the phone. Sometimes over through message, whether that's maybe it's through Messenger, somebody inquires, or maybe through through email. But most of the time, it's going to be over the phone. We book that estimate.
Understood. Okay, so you're probably going to do. Let me go back to create. Probably do a conversions for leads. I'm going to make this simpler, and I'm going to choose traffic. I'm going to choose traffic. Same idea. You're saying, hey, Facebook, show my ad to people who are most likely to click my ad. Okay. Mm-hmm. So traffic. Again, you can use conversions. I'm not worried about that right now. So traffic or conversions. Okay. Conversions is a little bit harder to set up. It's not hard. It's just harder. You have to set up your pixel, your Facebook pixel. Mm-hmm. Let me talk about that real quick.
Yeah.
So Facebook
pixel. I was about to say, yeah, some people are like, what's a pixel, you know?
They are asking that?
No, I'm saying if someone were watching this, they'd be like, what's a pixel? They don't know
what that is. Okay, let's talk about that. So the Facebook pixel is kind of like, imagine going on a road trip. Okay, I just recently drove to New Jersey for my in-laws. And I definitely needed my GPS. The pixel is like Facebook's GPS. It's their eyes. It allows them to see what in the world is happening. So if I fill out a form, okay. So if I click your ad, Winston, mm-hmm. and I land on a page where I'm like, oh, hey, this is a cool offer for a moving company. I don't really want to move myself. I want someone else to do it. I give you my information. I fill out the form. I click submit. On that next page that I land on is a lead event code. Okay. So when someone lands on that page, Facebook goes, we just got a lead. We got what the person was looking for, a conversion for leads. Okay. But Facebook can see it because there's a little snippet of code, of HTML code that you put on a website. Okay. It's literally just copy and paste. You put on a website, and now Facebook can see what in the world is happening. Without that pixel, if you take someone off Facebook, Facebook can't see it, can't see what's happening. Mm-hmm. Okay. Does that make sense?
Yeah, totally.
So, and Facebook, think of Facebook. Facebook's fancy. They have, you know, billions of dollars. They've developed these crazy artificial intelligence machines. They want to help us, right? So if we write a good ad that people in, that are engaging and clicking and all the things that they do on Facebook, if they're engaging with the ad, then Facebook will reward us, right? Because they want to show ads that people like, mm-hmm. right? Because they need to, it's about their community. They need to show those ads that people like. And so by showing a good ad that people are engaged with, they'll reward you. And so they click your ad, they come to a page, they fill out the form, they submit it, come to the next page, we can now track that lead. Facebook will take that person, they have data points on us, okay? Mm-hmm. We'll take that person and go, okay, here's the data points of this person. I'm gonna take that Facebook's gonna take that information, go back to that audience that we're targeting, we're gonna get into that in a minute, mm-hmm. go back to the audience and go, okay, who else in this audience has these same data points?
Yeah.
So it's constantly learning and helping us. Okay. So
let's pause on that, because I think that's a point that a lot of people will find value in, is the consistency in running these ads, right? Because what will happen is we will have owners run maybe a form of marketing, and then they may not see the numbers that maybe they expected, or maybe in income, maybe financially they became strapped a little bit, and they turn it off for a while. What's that? That's going to affect us, right?
Yeah. So the, whatever you want to call it, we'll call it an algorithm. The mm-hmm. algorithm, Facebook's full, right? So people who are like pausing and starting and pausing and starting ads, that's your question.
Right.
Whether it hurts us or not. Right. So, let me stop sharing here real quick so I can see you. And I feel like I'm talking to somebody on my screen.
Right. Right.
Through this part, I'll go back to sharing. So Facebook's full, right? Mm-hmm. It has enough ad, they're not looking for more advertisers, mm-hmm. right? So if you own all the real estate, mm-hmm. how do you make more money? Is there more real estate to buy? Well, you charge more for your real estate, or you make more per piece of real estate, right? Mm-hmm. So the way that Facebook works now, it's kind of a three-tiered system. So you have your A tier advertiser, B tier, C tier, right? Your A tier advertiser, they don't care how much you spend. They just don't want you to stop spending, right? Mm-hmm. Because in their mind, if you don't stop spending money, you can spend a dollar a day. If you don't stop spending money, you will eventually spend more money, right? So they give the best inventory, the best pricing to your A tier advertisers. People just consistently run ads. Then you have your B tier. That's the people who they advertise consistently, but they have budget caps set under their accounts and they hit them. And then on the 26th of the month, they stop. Right. And then all the way to the 31st. And then on the 1st, they reset it. Right. As an example. So they're consistent, but it's on and off. Okay, that's your B tier advertiser. And then your C tier, that's the people who boost posts and it's very sporadic, right? We want to be the A tier, right? Because we want the best inventory, because we get rewarded for that stuff. Best inventory, best pricing, all that. So it's not to say you can't ever not run ads, because there's definitely times where, you know, you got to shut things off, right?
Yeah.
Whether you're building new ads or if something's not working, then you got to fix it. So you got to shut them off. So it's not to say you can't ever stop running ads, but it's important. You're hurting yourself by being sporadic, right? You're
it's about the reason why you're turning them off. It's if you're turning them off just because, you know, maybe you don't believe in it fully yet or something like that. Well, it needs to be a more valid reason. Hence, like you were saying, you know, we need to change it or we need to make tweaks.
Sure. Something like that. Like it's only going to be off for just a little bit, mm-hmm. right? Maybe off for like 2 days or something like that. And then it's right back on.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So, it's important to consistently advertise. All right, let's go back to screen share.
Yeah.
Okay. So, based on what you said, you want me to dive into this? I can dive into it. Let's do it. Okay. So instead of traffic, I'm going to run the one that I would actually really recommend, which is conversions. Okay. So we'll go to continue. All right. So the way this Facebook has structured this, first of all, up here in the top right, if you go back through the replay on this, we're doing a replay. You're letting people.
Yep. Yeah. Gotcha. So anybody watching this now, if you got to jump off in a minute, you know, that's fine. You're going to be able to get access to this. For free. You'll be able to jump back on this and watch it fully at another time. So good for everybody.
You're the man, Winston. All right. So up here on the top right, we always turn these off because if you forget to do that, you can accidentally, it'll run as soon as Facebook approves it. And if you weren't actually ready for it to run, then you might waste some money there. So always, it's a good habit to have, turn that off. Okay. You can name this. So real quick, I'm not going to spend a lot of time in this, but if you do this for any sort of time, you will love yourself if you label your campaigns. So give it a nice little label of the, you know, let's say the way that we do this in our agency is we give it our agency name and then the type of advertising or program that we're doing this for. So let's say that we're doing forced moves, and then a date. So 10/26, 2020. This, I'm telling you, it'll come in handy later on in the future. Let me just highlight this real quick. Special ad categories. So this is things like, if you're hiring someone, you want to run an employment ad. If you're a realtor and you're selling a house, or if you were in politics, running ads for that, special ad categories, you all won't need that unless you're going to sell a house. Oh, nothing here, nothing here. Campaign budget optimization. I get this question a lot. Essentially, what's the easy way to explain this? So campaign budget optimization, in our next step, we're going to be doing the targeting, Winston. And so mm-hmm. you can have, you know, you want to separate your targeting by who you're talking to, right? Remember the sniper rifle approach. Yeah. So you can have inside of a campaign, it's like a file folder. So, you know, inside this big file folder, you have a bunch of different file folders in that one.
Right.
And then in those file folders, you have your papers that go in there, right? Okay. And that's your ad, right? So inside the campaigns, we have the ad sets, which is our targeting and where we're showing the ad. And so by using campaign budget optimization, we're saying, hey, Facebook, I want you to put my ad and spend my money in the targeting that's doing the best instead of you personally managing that budget and where and how that money is distributed. Make sense?
Yeah, I'm following.
If it doesn't, at any point, please, you're going to be my guide if I didn't explain things thoroughly enough for you.
I'm the guy that I was a C student, so I, you know.
hey, me too.
The teacher had to teach it to me like 6 times, and then I still missed, you know, I still only got 75%, so.
There you go. I am a fan of this and I use it all the time and I like to turn it on. Next thing, campaign budget. So budgeting, so let's talk about, all right, the one of the elephant in the room questions. How much do I spend on Facebook?
Yeah.
The real answer to that is, I don't know. Because number one, every market is different.
Yeah.
Okay. Number two, you have to reverse engineer the whole process. Okay. So you have to find out, okay, how much am I spending on average to get a new customer?
Mm-hmm.
Right. And what's the average, if you were to average out how much somebody, a moving company makes, what's like the average ticket?
Average job value. Yeah. I mean, it depends the type of operations they're running, but let's say an average full service move could be anywhere from $800 to $1,200.
$800, $1,200. Okay. $800, $1,200. Let's call it $1,000 for easy math. How about that? That's right in the middle. $1,000. Can you see my calculator?
Yep.
Cool. So, you know, let's say you spend $1,000. Spend $1,000, you get three new customers, you made $3,000.
Right.
3,000 divided by 3 is $1,000. Your average cost to acquire a member is $1,000.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It's such easy math. Like, I can literally, and now the math never works out perfect, right? But it's pretty darn close. And then every, you know, you have your good months and your low months and your good months and your low months, things like that, right?
Yeah.
But that's what we have to find out first. What's our cost to acquire to get a new customer, mm-hmm. right? And then after you spend enough money, you'll be able to have a nice little average of that. Again, yeah. Every month's going to be different. It's going to go up and down, up and down. Excuse me.
Now, sidebar here. This is one of the...
Oh, I'm sorry. I did this math wrong.
I was going to say... I
see your face. I'm like, in my head, I'm like, did I do this math wrong? It's We spent $1,000 divided by three customers, $333.
Yeah. people are like, what?
Isn't this guy supposed to be an expert or something?
Now, that's what calculators are for, and double-checking math.
But you got to have the human component to that calculator.
Yeah. User error. So let's talk about for a second ROI in tracking this. So maybe I'm jumping ahead here, Logan, but when someone is running this form of marketing and advertising, are they going to be able to see a breakdown in the Facebook manager of their numbers? Because that's a big thing. I find a lot of owners, you ask them, well, what are you running marketing? You know, what type of marketing are you doing? And they'll throw out some things, but they don't know their ROI numbers. So how can we know our ROI numbers?
So you probably won't be able to see the end result, meaning you get a new customer, you get a new contract, right? Sure.
Mm-hmm.
You're not gonna be able to track that inside Facebook.
Right.
But you can track the rest of it all the way up to that point. So we have a very simple spreadsheet to do it. Let me.
Be something that we're recommending this to an owner. This is something that either themselves or whoever they're working with, and a separate spreadsheet or separate tracking sheet outside of the Facebook platform.
Yeah. You just won't be able to track everything.
Right.
Unless you're doing like e-commerce or something like that. Right. Then you can. But
right. Because Facebook doesn't know when you ring up that customer, you know, how many hours the job took and what the bill came out to.
Exactly. So it's a very simple spreadsheet. Let me get pulled up here. So can you see this okay? So amount spent, we just grab that. Let me put this in the same window here. So amount spent, we just grab that from, so like this client of ours this month, he spent $190.
Okay.
All right. So 190, monthly rate, obviously, you know, you can grab amount spent from Facebook, monthly rate. So this will be, instead of monthly rate, this would be, total sales. So let's say we got three customers spending, let's say we spent $1,000 and we got three customers at 800, 900 and 1,000. So 800, 900, 1,000. So $2,700. This is not, disregard this one. I'm not going to delete it because we use this, but disregard this. This is a lifetime value number. So total sales. So you won't be able to track total sales for what you're doing. And then we come over here. This is where we reverse engineer it all. Okay. Mm-hmm. So instead of let's just go ahead and get rid of this, and let's do a little bit different for, so leads, I would just input how many leads I have. So you can track that within Facebook.
Yep.
So leads, this is just a column that's in here. So this guy got 103. Let's just use this one for the sake of it. And then we calculate. So it's just a nice little formula. It's just equals, this is a Google Sheets. So we just do equals total spent divided by how many leads we got. Total spent divided by how many leads we got. So each lead costs us roughly $10.
Yep.
That's trackable inside Facebook, cost per lead right here. Appointment booked. We want to find out what's our cost to get a new appointment, right?
Right.
Not showed up for a phone call, but or for to meet them, but for just booking. So out of the 103, what's the average appointment rate, would you say?
Appointment rate, you know, booking conversion, I would say, you know, we want to see somewhere around 70% plus would be nice. Yeah.
Say 72.
50 to 70. Yeah.
Okay. And then same thing for show rate.
Show rate.
With you, right?
Sorry.
I was saying, unless they're working with you, right?
Oh, right. Yeah. 100%. Show rate. Typically, if they book an appointment, I would say 85% of those people are going to honor their appointment.
Good numbers. 61. We're going to skip this one. So in this scenario here, we spent $1,000. We got 61 people to show up for their appointment, a phone call, whatever the type of appointment is. We're just dividing all of these by whatever the appointment amount spent is to give us a cost per. That's really what we want to track in order to reverse engineer this thing. Because in the end, and then however many new sales you got. So if we got three new sales, it costs us $333 to get a new sale.
Yeah.
So we just reverse engineer this. It's like, okay, what's the most important part of this whole thing? Typically it's the show, right? Because this is going to determine how many opportunities you actually have to sell. Yeah.
Real actual opportunities.
So it's like, okay, how many appointments do I want to show up? Roughly I'm paying about $16 per show.
Mm-hmm.
So my next question is how fast and how often can I spend $16 on Facebook? All right. So I may go, okay. So when we go to the budget part, which was the next part of this, I may say, hey, daily budget, $16. Let's get an appointment a day.
Right.
Or, hey, maybe
let's pause right here. Cause this is a good spot to pause. So if you're a company owner and let's say you're an owner operator without a moving consultant, without a sales rep. Okay. Then you should have an idea of how many estimates you can get done in your calendar day, roughly. Okay. So if you have a sales rep, then think about this, do the math for the day. How many hours is that rep going to be in the office? What's your average estimate time? And you can work a lot of the numbers out. So, I mean, it's not gonna be perfect, but you want to know how many estimates your team can hold and do on a daily basis. That's important for this.
Gotcha. Maybe, you know, number show, number of estimates given, something like that. Number of estimates, yeah. Something like
another,
that.
Another part to this too, that folks really need to know about and think about is how tight your sales process is. That's going to be the hinge point right there. So if you rock this part and you have the lead flow, you have to be thinking about, do we have someone to pick up the phone? Are they skilled on the phone? Okay. So that's the other part, right? Sales and marketing are not the same thing. They're two very different things. So if you're thinking about marketing, you have to think about sales as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. And what's cool about this little spreadsheet here, we use this all the time. It's like, okay, where's the bottleneck, right? Mm-hmm. Where do we suck and where are we really good?
Right.
Right. Cause if you calculate this as a percentage in here, you're just doing basic formulas equals, I mean, you can Google all this stuff. D17, what is D17? Oh, it's 72. So 72 divided by, what is B17? This one? Oh, just the one before. 72 divided by 103. That's going to give me my percentage. Mm-hmm. You know, if this was 40 and I crush, and I'm crushing on show, right? Mm-hmm. I know where my bottleneck is.
Yeah.
38% book rate, there's a problem, right? Mm-hmm. I'm really good over here, but I don't have the leads. It's not calculated as a percentage.
Now here's a question someone may have, because this is what a lot of companies do, is when they get a customer on the phone from the lead, that a lot of times these customers, sometimes they just want quick pricing. They just say, hey, can you just give me a quote? And they just want, they don't necessarily want to set up a whole appointment. They don't necessarily want someone coming out to the house and being there for 45 minutes to an hour. They just, hey, what's the price? Here's how big my home is. I have 3-bedroom, 2-bath. And moving from here to here. So how do we, Logan, what would your recommendation be when you have those types of people? How do we figure that? Do we want to go ahead and for our numbers, do we want to count that as, okay, that was really an estimate? Because if they're like, hey, we want numbers now, and if you can, you absolutely want to go ahead and get them, you know, numbers and get that process rolling on the phone while you have them there, because in 24 hours, they're gone. So what's your recommendation in that case?
To have a standard and then stick to it.
Good.
So every business owner is going to be a little bit different. Have your columns, or however you do this, whether you use a spreadsheet or whatever you're doing, you do it on whatever you're doing. However you separate it, I would lump it all together. So even if it's, instead of going that deep, that's very detailed, which is cool, but you know, you're going to have, especially if you're running, you have to understand this on Facebook. Nobody goes to Facebook looking for a moving company, right? Mm-hmm. It's different marketing. It's not a bad thing. You just have to understand the psychology behind Facebook marketing. Mm-hmm. Nobody goes that, people go to Facebook to be entertained, right? Mm-hmm. When I say Facebook, I'm also saying Instagram, because they're both run from the same platform.
Yeah.
So it's not like a Google search where someone's looking for moving companies near me or something of that nature, right? That's a different lead, because there's intent behind a Google search. Facebook, there's not intent. And it's, again, it's not a bad thing. Right. It's just, we have to understand that when we're marketing. So based on this, since we are talking about Facebook, you're going to get, you know, the leads that fill out a form and then you just never hear from them. Mm-hmm. You're going to get the ones that fill out a form, but you got to follow up, right? And then you're going to get the ones that, the hot leads that are, sweet, this is awesome. I hate moving and I have to move right now.
Right, right.
Let me give my information. You just had to call them up, right? Mm-hmm. So you'll get those three types of leads. I would put them all into, I mean, I wouldn't make like a separate category for them all. I'd track them all in the same thing. It's gonna average out, right? Yeah. You're gonna have the ones that are hot. You're gonna have the cold leads. You're gonna have the warm leads, which are majority of what you're gonna do, the ones that need follow-up, that's going to be the majority of your Facebook leads. And so does that answer your question? I wouldn't do something separate. I would just keep, set a standard and rock and stick with it.
For people watching, the whole point of me even jumping on that part is, if you get those people, because this is super prevalent with moving, right? Any type of service-based industry, you know, you get a lot of people that just want that quick quote. Okay, so service the quick quote, like service that. I would not recommend putting them off and saying, oh, well, we have to do an on-site estimate, because some people are busy. Maybe they don't want you to come to the house, and you miss out on them if you don't go ahead and get them those numbers and get them that coordination for the move, and make sure you do good lead capture, which the leads, it's already produced a lot of information, but you on the phone are able to get even more. So that might be, you know, understanding what size home they have, understanding, you know, the nature of their move, specifics there, as far as, you know, different levels you're working on, et cetera, et cetera. So the skill on the phone is important.
Cool. Cool. That's good stuff.
And all right. For that, for people watching too, that little sheet that Logan had, I'm pretty sure Logan had that built out for a separate client probably. So you would just build this out to your business, right? So it may not look exactly like Logan's here. Okay.
If you want, I can, I'll share this with you and you can post in like the comments or something.
Yeah.
And then maybe edit it just to make it a little bit more specific for moving industry.
Yeah.
And have it ready for that. But I can share that with you so that you can share it with everybody in the comments. Cool. So that's daily budget. You have to reverse engineer until you have some data on, okay, I've gotten X number of customers from Facebook, then you just got to spend some money. So then the question is, how much money do I spend? I'm going to recommend, and this is different for everybody. The good news is that most of these moving companies are local businesses, but they're more of a regional type of business. So your audiences are much larger than a restaurant or,
right,
I don't know, a dentist, something like that, right? So anywhere between 20 to 50 bucks is what I would say is a good starting spot a day.
Yeah.
Now, if you go less than that, you start doing 10 or 5 or something like that, because you're just unsure. You don't have the confidence. Like, am I wasting my money? Nobody wants to waste their money, right?
Right.
But here's the thing. You're going to spend $5 a day, and over the course of a week, you're going to spend 35 bucks. I can spend, and you're going to take a week to find out, hey, am I on the right track or am I not?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Or I could spend $35 in one day and I can get that information today. I go, am I on the right track or am I not? It's speed. Right. Okay.
Yeah.
So, you know, for everybody out there, don't do little tiny little budgets like this. It's not worth your money and the effort. I'm not saying go big or go home, but you know, put some speed. Okay.
Yeah.
So, say 30 bucks. All right, moving forward. All right, you can leave everything here alone. We did a conversion event. So let's do this real quick. Over here on the left-hand side, business.facebook.com. That's where we're at. Mm-hmm. Over here on the left-hand side is the little menu button for business tools. You're going to click that and you're looking for events manager. Okay, I'm going to open this up in a new tab so I don't lose what I'm doing over here. Events over here. Where did that go? Events manager is what you want. Events manager. So here, so Facebook is able to track like what in the world's happening. And you can't see, like, they have even deeper information than this. But this is the pixel. This is the pixel. If you don't have a pixel, you'll go over here to the left and you'll click this little green button, connect data sources. Mm-hmm. And you're going to do web. And then you're going to do Facebook pixel.
Mm-hmm.
Just give your pixel a name, just whatever your business is. So business name. So it doesn't really matter what this is. Really has zero relevance. I've never put a website in here because you don't have to, and there's no need to. So just once you've named your pixel, just click continue. And I'm going to kind of fly through this little part here because nobody's going to be doing this live with us. But when you go back through, you can watch. So you're going to manually, most of us, if you have like Squarespace or WordPress or I don't know why a moving company would have Shopify, but maybe there's a reason. Some of the main platforms have a partner integration and you just use this. For everybody else, myself included into this, you're going to use install code manually. If you are not a tech savvy person, give this to your web guy. They should know this isn't new stuff. This has been out for a very long time, several years now. So this isn't new stuff. Everybody who messes with a website should know how to do this. Plus, pretty much every website provider out there, if you do your websites yourself, has documentation on how to install your Facebook pixel.
Yeah.
Okay. This code right here, this all this gibberish in here. You're just going to click copy code. This is your main pixel code. This goes on every page of your website. Typically, you put it in one spot and it puts it everywhere. Mm-hmm. It's typically 99% of the time how that works. You just copy the code. You just copy the code and put it where it's supposed to go for your website provider. I can't, every website provider is different, so I'm not going to go into any of that, but all this gibberish you just put in there. And then one more step. Let me give the visual on this. Let me open this up. Bear with me just a moment.
Yeah.
Let me get one of our funnels open here. Marketing funnels, funnels, funnels. Almost there. Let's do a kids martial arts one. All right. Name of the game is simplicity for everybody. This is some extra. I'm not going to dive into landing page. I don't think we have the time for that. I mean, if you really want to, Winston, I'm happy to do it, but this is like a subject on its own.
Let's skip over that because okay. I want to keep us focused on the campaign. Sure. And then if people really want some more on the landing page, maybe we can look
at it. Maybe we'll do another one. Okay. So I do need to show this for the pixels stuff. Okay. So you have wherever someone clicks your ad, they come to this page, whatever that page is, there should be a form on there. And they, when you submit the form, whatever that next page is, I am now a lead. I just filled out a form, right? Mm-hmm. I'm a lead, right? There should be a lead event code in your Facebook pixel, a lead event code. That's the next step of this. If we click continue, yes, turn on advanced matching, click continue. Oh, they just changed this. One of these buttons, that's not it. Sorry.
No, you're good.
There we go. No, that's not it either. Install code manually. They literally just changed this.
While Logan's looking at that, if you're get a chance to watch this, you're watching now, and you're like, holy cow, this is overwhelming. Well, as an owner, here's my recommendation. When we consult with clients, we say, okay, look at everything that happens in your business, every single task, every single thing that has to happen, and think about it in dollars. So if it's a $10 an hour task, if it's a $50 an hour task, it's a $100 an hour task, if it's a $1,000 an hour task, figure out how to automate things, figure out how to delegate and contract out someone else to be doing this. Because as an owner, in my opinion, you would spend a lot of time. You basically need to, hours and hours of figuring out different nuances to this. You know, what we recommend is find someone that's a specialist. And when the numbers line up for your business, and this is the type of marketing you want to utilize, then at that point, do it the right way. I wouldn't recommend someone that didn't know anything of what they're doing to just jump right in, right? So if you're overwhelmed looking at this and watching, don't be overwhelmed. Just look at, okay, wow, this is a really in-depth kind of look through the eyeglass, and there's a whole world of this out there for people to market their business.
Absolutely. Absolutely. This was the code I was looking for. Perfect. This little piece of code tells Facebook that, hey, you just got a lead. Mm. Which gives us all the, well, you saw all the stats before. I got this window open, but you see all the stats. So a little bit techie. It's not, I think the fact that it's HTML code makes it feel really techie. It's really not. You're literally just going in here. You're copying that code in here. you're pasting it or giving it to whoever takes care of your website or landing pages, okay, where you're sending the traffic from your ads. And then that's it. And then you got to put this little piece of code only on the next page after they fill out the form.
Yeah.
So now Facebook knows, hey, someone landed on this page. The only way to get here is to fill out that form. So they just became a lead.
Yeah.
Yeah. Does that make sense the way I explained that?
Yeah. Yeah. And I think, and for some people, I mean, this is how I would be. I mean, go back, you might just have to go back and rewind a little bit of this and just see some of the movements that he did through the progression there. But I mean, once you know those movements and what you need to click, then it's done. You build it.
Done. You set it up once and you're done.
Yep.
Cool. Okay. Conversion event. So we're in the targeting now. We're in the ad set in the targeting. We're going for leads. That's what we want to optimize for. We want to tell Facebook, hey, I want, get me people who are most likely to become a lead. So we go here, lead. Scrolling down, we don't need dynamic creative. I don't know anybody that uses this offer thing here. So I'm not going to get into it. We talked about A tier, B tier, and C tier. So you can put an end date if you're running like some sort of like a Black Friday special, I guess, or any kind of promotional offer like that that has a definite end date. But for the most part, we don't want to stop. So no end dates. All right, locations. Let's talk about locations or targeting. So I'm going to give you my highest recommendation, which is target. I'm going to dive a little bit more into this, into things that you can try out. I will tell you, marketing is about trying things and testing it. But a little, the cool thing, you don't have to, this isn't radio ads where you got to spend $1,000, right? Or whatever a radio ad costs now. You can spend $20, $30 and then go, okay, it didn't work. Or you went, hey, this worked. Let's put more money into it. Right. You don't have to spend a bunch of money. So my recommendation is to start targeted, but broad. Here's what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever, I would say whatever the business's location is, put in, I don't know. Put in your business location. They just changed this now. So now you can also type in like the name of a place. So you can type in the name of your business.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just go like this. All right. So there's a couple of different ways you can select location. Let me get rid of Canada here. You can select location. You can do a circle or radius, and you can select how far out you want to go. How far out would you say we should go, Winston? What's the typical distance?
Yeah, if they're running a local moving to me is maybe you're within about 60 miles.
60. And then,
yeah, like an hour. You know, if you're about an hour out, we would consider that local.
Gotcha. So on here, you can go 50, right? You can add more dots though. You can, if you click this drop pin button, you can drop a pin anywhere in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So let's say right here's Winchester. Boom. And then you can select your radius onto that. So if you want to go a little bit further out than just this first circle,
mm-hmm.
right? You can also exclude places. So it's like, okay, I went over here into Pennsylvania, just mm-hmm. as an example here, Pennsylvania. So I'm just, I don't want to work in Pennsylvania. You can also exclude locations. You can exclude a city, a zip code, same thing as include. You can put in by zip code, city, a state, or a circle.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good.
Let's get rid of this and we'll just leave it right there. All right. Age. So this is where we need to go. Okay. Who in the world am I talking to? Mm-hmm. All right. We were talking about the sniper rifle before.
Mm-hmm.
Who's the most common, just for, let me do it this way. Let's do, let me stop and let me do a whiteboard.
Yeah.
Cause this is marketing right here. What we're about to do. So let's talk about and this is a mouse, so I apologize for the terrible handwriting on this, but it's not handwriting, it's mouse clicking. Let's talk about audience, who we're advertising to, okay?
Yeah.
So instead of saying, hey, everybody between 18 and 65 plus, right, radio ad, let's talk to somebody specifically, mm-hmm. right? Who's the most common, who would you say is the most common customer, Winston, for a moving company? Tell me what they look like and their demographics.
Mm-hmm. You have probably a couple categories.
Let's pick one. We can talk about a bunch.
Let's highlight the downsizing scenario. So we've got parents that have children that are now out of the home. They have this 3,500 square foot house and it's just two people living in it. And they're like, let's move somewhere smaller. So if we think, okay, let's say they had children when they were 25, and then let's say their children move out when they're 20. So that would be somewhere between, let's just call it 40 to 50 years old, or 45 to 55, somewhere in that bracket.
Do you see how we just all of a sudden, whoa, we're talking about downsizing. We're talking about, you know, couples with older kids, mm-hmm. between 40. You see how our message just completely changed instead of 18 to 65 plus?
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. That's right there. That's the power of Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Anything else about this person? We could actually probably stop there, but anything else that sticks out about them?
Well, they're getting a little bit higher in age. So physically, they're probably not going to want to do the DIY version of moving.
Okay.
Physical part is a factor for them. They're probably not physically wanting to do that work.
They're still working?
Probably still working. Probably not retired yet. Okay. Closer to retirement. They may be thinking about retirement. So this isn't the category of, this really isn't retired where they're moving to maybe, you know, a retired community, like a retirement community. They're not moving there. They're just moving. They're just getting maybe a smaller home.
Understood. Okay. So I'm going to make this a little bit smaller. Oh, dang it. I didn't want to do that. That's okay. I'll come back to that. Screen one. Okay. So now we have a better idea of who our audience is. Mm-hmm. Each audience is a separate ad set, by the way. It was super easy to create an ad set once one is created. Mm-hmm. And maybe I'll show that it's literally just two clicks of a button. Yeah. Okay. So we have our location. Let's do age. So our age that we were talking about is 40.
Mm-hmm. 40 to 55. Yep.
55. Right. What's the ratio? You know, you did a great job in moving sales. What's the ratio of men to women that who you make the sale to?
Yeah, probably going to be 65, 35 women being the majority. Yeah.
Okay. 65, 35. You could advertise to men or women separately. Again, you can see how the message would change.
Mm-hmm.
If you're advertising just a guy versus advertising to a woman.
Mm-hmm.
For our example here, I'm going to leave it here. Just know that you can do that.
Yeah.
And that it's powerful to do that. Right. And then detailed targeting. This is your interest. So this is like deep diving inside of this large audience. So we got 580,000 potential people that we can market to from what we've selected,
mm-hmm.
in this location, excluding Pennsylvania in my example, 40 to 55, both men and women. We can take this a step further. I'm going to tell you right now, I just want to show this part just to give people some ideas of things to try.
Yeah.
But I will tell you right now, start with what I just showed you. If you want, just give me the cheat codes. What I just showed you right here, 40 to 55 for this, the audience type that we're talking about that's trying to downsize.
Mm-hmm.
Don't go any further. Start there. And then once you get that working, then move into trying other different things. But you can do like parents. So we talked about that. Mm-hmm. So these are parent, there it is. Parents with adult children.
Yep.
So let's just go ahead and select that. Oh, what's going on here? Detailed targeting expansion, this little checkbox. The reason potential reach didn't change is because we said, hey, Facebook, if you feel like you can expand outside of the targeting that I'm giving you, go ahead and do it. Okay. Honestly, I wouldn't do that. That's the same thing as just doing no interests. Okay. In my opinion. I don't know if that's 100% factual, but I would, yeah, that's what I would do. So now we went from 580 to 73,000.
Yeah, targeted.
Yep. What's some other ones? So professionals, you can look by people who have a professional degree.
Mm-hmm.
Right, they probably got some money.
Yep.
Yeah. Each one of these is a separate ad set. The reason I say that is because if you go, okay, I'm going to put in all these different, what about moving? Someone who has an interest in a moving company, that might be a good one to try out,
mm-hmm.
right? I'll leave it right there for the time being. if I spend money on this targeting right here and it does really well, which one of these did really well? I have no idea, because they're lumped together. So you have to run separate ad sets. Again, it's not hard to do that. It's actually two clicks of a button, and I'll do that at the end here. But just know that when you do this, it has to be separate, or should be. It doesn't have to be, but you definitely should be. Mm-hmm. That way you know where you're effective with your money and where you're not.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Again, I am going to leave this open. This is where I would go. Real quick on placements. This is saying, hey, Facebook, show my ad wherever you think it's best. And it says recommended. I disagree. There's a lot of, this is everywhere that you could show your ad, right? Messenger sponsored messages in some sort of Facebook instant article. I've never even seen those things. I don't even know where that's at.
Right.
Apps and sites, like partner places, like all of this is stuff that I have found that I waste a lot of money on.
Yeah.
So I unselect everything except for Facebook news feed and Instagram feed. Mm-hmm. If you want to expand outside of that, by all means, these are the main winners right there.
Mm-hmm. And Logan, what, correct me if I'm wrong, right? But that's going to lower our costs, or it's going to allow us not to waste money. Because that's correct. Money spent on putting a fee, you know, an ad, where was it? Messenger inbox, otherwise, you know,
or the right column. I haven't clicked a right column ad since
right like column ad. Yeah. Yeah. So put the money to where the heavy hitters are.
Exactly.
Mm, yeah.
You got it. Again, if you want to try outside of that, that's a test. You have to try it, but start where everybody's at. Everybody who goes onto Facebook or Instagram, everybody, 100% of the people are in the feed.
Mm-hmm.
And then one more thing, conversion window. This is for like e-commerce, 7 days, where, you know, you sell something, somebody abandons the cart, and then they got emails to get them to come back in.
Right.
So people don't actually purchase right from the ad that same day. So for what we're doing, we're generating leads. So one day click. It's a ninja tip right there. One day click. That's it. We're done with ad set. Questions before I move on?
No, we're good.
Cool. Now we're creating the ad, the fun part. you select your Facebook page here. If you have an Instagram account, you'll select it as well. And you can leave this right alone. So you can do a carousel ad, meaning like a slideshow kind of a thing. Everybody's seen carousel ads. Mm-hmm. You have multiple pictures or videos within the ad. Mm-hmm. You got to use, typically you're going to do a single image or video.
Mm-hmm.
But if you come up with, you know, a nice little carousel, that's something to try. But for the most part, single image or video. Mm-hmm. I've never used collection. We can skip these moving forward. So media, ad creative, the media. So we add media, you can add an image or a video. I recommend running multiple ads and trying different things. Maybe you could do a quick, I will tell you our best performing ad of all time is 11 seconds long. A video 11 seconds long is just a talking head video, right, with a nice message. We'll also tell you that this is an old stat from Facebook, directly from Facebook, but it's probably higher now. I haven't looked it up in quite a while. Facebook a couple of years ago put out a stat that 80% of the people scrolling through the news feed listen to it on silent. Right? So if you're talking in a talking head video, you need to caption your video.
Yep.
What I mean by that, if you do ad video, let's just say you do this one right here. And, you know, imagine that if this was happening, you had no idea what's happening. You're listening to this thing on silent. Like if there was a real message here, then you wouldn't know what it is. So once you upload the video, if you go to, you upload it, you click edit. You have your thumbnail over here. You can trim it. You can crop it. Another ninja tip, I recommend 1-to-1 square. It takes up more real estate on someone's phone, which is the majority of the traffic you're going to be getting. Mm-hmm. It takes up more real estate on the phone. More real estate you take up, the more chances you have of grabbing someone's attention and keeping it.
Mm-hmm.
So square versus like a horizontal video that takes up just a small portion of the screen, mm-hmm. right? Square is going to take up almost the whole thing. Thumbnail. This is the, this is what people see before the ad plays. Okay. This is also really important because it's going to grab their attention. You can automatically select it from a video, or you can click manual. You can upload your own or select it from a piece from the video. What you want is something that stands out. You want, it's called a pattern interrupt, right? So you think about it. Someone's scroll. Let me stop sharing. Someone's scrolling through Facebook, scrolling, and they're in this pattern, right?
Wow.
Something stands out to them, it stops them. Whoa, what is that, right? Mm-hmm. Pattern interrupt. So you want something that stands out. Something cool would be, what would be something cool? Get creative here and help me out here, Winston. Somebody dropping something on their foot as they're moving.
Yeah.
Grab my attention. That was the first thing that popped in my head. Maybe good or bad, I don't know, but color stands out. Good.
Yeah, color contrast, the number one yellow is the number one color to the eyeball for contrast, actually. So if you have a yellow background on some, that would catch them.
Good information.
You know, in sales, we have a couple different ways. You can play to somebody's, what somebody wants, which would be like their passions or what makes them joyful. But what's more effective is what is fear or something that's like makes them worried or doubtful. So it's not always the nicest thing, but like a negative influencer has a higher impact on someone. So
gotcha.
So like you said,
like hating moving, somebody who hates it, like me, like break my foot or something, I would rather that happen than have to move all my crap. Right. So yeah.
Or maybe it's a terrible example, a person standing there with a glass, like a glass vase that just dropped and there's pieces like literally, and they're like, that would catch you. Right.
Or a bunch of boxes. This would be cool. A bunch of boxes like around someone and they're just like this or like crying or I don't know, something like that.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Or like a crying emoji into that picture.
You could. And this is a creative design kind of stuff. It's like, this is the testing.
Or a talking head video where you go, we'll do Northern Virginia. Hey, Northern Virginia, this is Logan with XYZ Moving Company. If you're like most people and you're in the process of moving or thinking about moving and all of a sudden comes a time where you got to pack everything up and you got to deal with the giant headache of moving, well, guess what? I'm here to help you so you don't have to do it at all. What if someone came in and did it for you? That's what we do here. Here's a special offer. If you want to grab it, click the link below and we'll see you soon. Right? Nice little quick little video like that. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that was the best script ever, but again, our best performing ad of all time, 11 seconds long. And those little quick ads do better than the big long ads. Yeah. Even these beautiful storytelling videos, they do well, but they don't do as well typically as the little short 15, 20, 30 second videos.
Yeah. Yeah. Another idea is, you know, however you would frame this, but the strength portrayal. So if you've got like the mover with the shoulder harness deal or whatever, he's carrying like seven boxes on his back with a carry strap, like that's cool, right?
Yeah.
As
you're scrolling through, all of a sudden you see a dude with seven boxes on his back. How are you not going to look at that for at least a second? Like, what the heck is that? Right?
Yeah.
That's a great point. It's a good one. All right. So I'm sorry. I should have put together like something for you all. I don't have it, but we gave you some really good ideas there.
Yeah.
Right? Gave you some good ideas. You don't have to do a video. I recommend trying it though. It's worth it.
If somebody, you know, does this, what should they not put on there? Like, what's like a note? Like, is there like a do not put?
Wait, so one of the things is you can't have more than 20% of the text in your thumbnail, not the video. If you do a video, you can have text into it, but not on the thumbnail. Okay. If you do an image, you can't have more than 20% of the image have text into it. You can't do that. You can have text, just can't take up more than 20% of the space of the image or thumbnail.
Now, is that a Facebook thing or is that like a recommendation? It's a Facebook thing. Yeah.
Yep. Okay. They'll ding you and you'll have less reach and higher costs if you do that.
Yeah.
Yep. So just don't do that. Other than that, I'll tell you, just find stuff that like some of the ideas that we just came up here would, I bet I'd put money on, would work very well.
Yeah.
And you got to try things. That's what it's about. Just try things. Yeah. Come up with a cool idea. Oh, okay. Let's try this. Right. You got the materials, you got the people. You know, if you're a really small team, then just, you know, have your wife or girlfriend take the picture or video and you know, just get creative.
Here's a really good one. I saw this one years ago when I was working for a franchise moving company. Was they had their moving truck, nice brand. They had their truck logo wrapped, and then they put a couch on top of the move truck, and the owners were sitting. Two owners, they were sitting on the couch on top of the truck. Cool. That stops you.
Yeah.
Not the brand.
Yeah. Or at least a second. Like, what the heck is that? Oh, it's a moving company.
Yeah.
Right. And sometimes they're not ready yet, but they will be. It's kind of a different subject, but you can retarget people who have engaged with your ad or clicked it before and stay just in front of those people. So, okay. Moving on. Text. Woo, this is a subject all on its own. Ad copy. I'm going to give you, there's so many different ways to do this. I'm going to give you a very simple, way to do this. And so it is, let me do it in here just so that it's easier to read. So call out, let me ask you this, Winston, with a moving company, typically you're hitting a lot of different areas. You're going 50 miles out. So there's a lot of different areas, aren't there? You can't say like for us, like Northern Virginia, because you'd be going outside of that.
Yeah. Yeah. So a lot of this is regional. I mean, if you're in like Massachusetts or up there in that greater Boston area, the geography up there, it's like you have a town, you drive 5 minutes, there's another town. You drive 5 minutes, there's another town. Whereas you may be in Virginia and it's always about 30 or 40 minutes apart from town, like an actual hub of an area. So
Gotcha. Sometimes
you, and I think, is that what you're talking about? Geography kind of?
Yeah. So typically we'll call out an area. And by the way, you could separate your targeting, run different ad sets to different cities.
Mm-hmm.
So like you could run it to a Winchester and then a Steven City and then mm-hmm. have another ad set for, I don't know, Strasbourg, and then for each individual city, mm-hmm. then you'll see where your money's, that's like one way to break down where your money would be most effective if you do that, which isn't a bad idea. A little bit more steps involved. It's not that many, but then you could do a call out like, hey, Winchester residents, something like that. So as you're scrolling, you have three chances to grab someone's attention. Mm-hmm. Let's put this in here real quick so we can see the preview. Winchester residents preview on headline. Oh, we didn't select media. I thought we did. Let me put an image in here real quick. This one. All right. Hopefully you can see this okay. This little preview here. So you got three chances to grab someone's attention. Number one is in the first three lines of the text. After the three lines, you get a little see more button before you can see the rest of it. Mm-hmm. Okay. So you got three lines to grab text to grab someone's attention. And then you have the image or video. That's number two. And then as they're scrolling, remember they're scrolling, looking for mm-hmm. pattern interrupts. And then you have the headline.
Yeah.
So you got three chances to grab their attention. So we need to utilize as much, you know, one way is to call out who your audience is. Another way is to do the same thing, but maybe in this case, you know, we're targeting such a broad area. We can't say, hey, specific area. So we want to call out who we want to talk to. So we're talking to people who are downsizing, right? So let's jump back to
homeowners. Maybe it's a homeowner.
What was our let me go back to that whiteboard here so that I can. So we were talking about people downsizing, so they are a homeowner. Mm-hmm. They're a homeowner, they're downsizing. Parent, they're a parent with older kids. So we want to talk to just these people. So
stop sharing. Another word, you know, empty nesters.
Some empty
phraseology.
I get where you're going with that, and I'm with you.
Could send us a different direction though.
Yeah, or someone's like just kind of like over maybe it would stick out. I'm not an empty nester, so I feel like it would grab my attention if I was though.
Right.
So it's not a bad idea. Something to try. Let's just keep this simple because this could go so many different ways.
Sure.
For time purposes here. So let's ask a question. That's where I'm going with this. Is I like to just ask a question that the person I'm talking to would say yes to. Mm-hmm. All right. So are you looking to move into a smaller home, something like that, and help me out here if you think of something, or the empty nesters?
Yeah, are you thinking about that downsizing?
I'm thinking about downsizing. Are you a homeowner
looking to move
that's dreading having to move?
Yeah.
Do you love let's be specific, moving about to move. That's an easy one right there.
Yeah.
Are you about to move? Everything up. pick it all up several times.
Yeah.
So the recipe here, the formula here is a call out or a question. Question dealing with their pain or their problem, right?
Yep.
Pain or problem, right? You're about to move, dread the fact, you have to pack everything up, pick it all up several times and cart it all over the place. I'm just thinking about this quick, but this could definitely be cleaned up. And then here's a little ninja trick. Take this first question and separate it on its own space. That way that question right there stands out alone instead of being jumbled up with the rest of the text.
Yeah.
Okay. Are you about to move? Dread the fact you have to pick everything up, cart it all over the place. What if we did have to, oh, you know what? They're downsizing. So check this out. What have they done before?
They've already moved.
Right. So let's talk about that.
So this is a great, so while Logan's typing out some stuff, this category of a person is someone that is a good chance they've paid for a mover before. What you're going to encounter is that group of people that didn't have a good experience with a professional mover maybe the last time. So they're going to have skepticism. They're going to be hesitant. And the trust level is going to be the most important part there. Money, they probably are going to be okay on the budget. It's going to be a matter of do they trust you.
For this demographic, you're saying.
Right, yeah. These are more established people. Yeah, budget-wise, they should be okay.
All right, so I liked what I said here, so I used it. Here's what I do. I write the same line over and over and over again until you write the one where you're like, that's it. And you know it as soon as you write it. You're like, that's it. That's the one.
Yeah.
Right. We did this first line here, you know, five times or whatever. And it was like, are you about to move? That's the one. Simple question, right to the point. Are you about to move? You've probably done this before. How much did you love moving?
And see what Logan's doing here is this is like, it's just the whiteboard idea. You know, you write something, you erase, you write something different. It's just trial and error. You have to see it. A lot of human beings are visual. And when you see something, you have to put your consumer hat on. Think about if you were the person looking at the ad, would it catch you? What kind of emotion would it, you know, give you if you read it and saw it?
What kind of emotion would it give us, Winston? You're this type of person. You're downsizing.
So if I read that ad,
some of the things that.
Well, one, it's gonna make me think about a question that's been in my subconscious mind, and we're pulling it to the conscious, because what we want that person to do is take action. The problem is they have to move, and it was terrible last time they did it.
They have to.
So they have to move, or they're about to move, and it was physically and mentally and emotionally exhausting.
Give me one or two more. There's something else they're going through with this whole thing. It's a problem or a pain.
The problem is maybe they recently had some type of surgery or, you know, a physical ailment. I mean, by the time someone gets to 50, just the truth in America is that you probably have some type of physical issues. Another problem could be finding help. So when you're in like your 20s, you've got like your beer drinking buddies. You got the guys that you could call up and they'll come help you in a pinch. By the time you're in your 40s and 50s, the truth is a couple things. One, socially, we don't want to do that because we don't want to have to put our friends through that pain or that effort. But also, you just may not have the people resource anymore. Most, if you're 50, who's most of your friends? They're probably similar age.
Yeah.
So you can't move the stuff. Then do you think Billy Bob, that's 52, do you think he's going to be able to do it?
Yeah. I'm going to skip the solution part over here because the solution is the moving company. But this is an excellent, excellent, excellent exercise to go instead of just trying to write it out like what I was doing. If you haven't done this a whole lot and, you know, you're not a writer or an ad copy type person, then this is an excellent exercise to, okay, here's what the heck do I talk about? Well, what's their problems and pains? And then right there is what we talk about. So I'm going to pick and then just pick one. I'm going to talk about this one right there. And I'm going to talk about this one.
Yeah.
Stop sharing, share. Probably done this before and can remember how physically and emotionally exhausting it was. Ooh, we're talking to some people now. All right, so we've hit their pain point, and we've kind of like, pain point is you're about to move. We kind of dug into the pain point a little bit by with this line here. Now, wouldn't it be great if you didn't have to do any of the work? That's what we do right now. Let's talk about an offer. All right. So first of all, let me stop sharing here because this is the meat and potatoes.
Yeah.
You can have the best ads in the world, the best sales funnel, the best, all this stuff. If you don't have an offer that people like, that the market responds to, none of it matters because they're not going to buy your thing, right? Yeah. So offer, in my opinion, is top two most important things about this whole thing.
Yeah.
Okay. So offer. What is, talk to me about an offer. And, and like, I don't want to hear like 10% off. Because
that's what, you know, we normally see is the, we'll give them 5 or 10% off, or we'll give them maybe a cash value offer. That's almost what 95% of people do. What if we were creative and just frame it so that way we're not giving them like way more. We're just framing it so that way it looks nicer. So it's attractive.
Repackaged.
Yes, we're repackaging it. So if you are going to give an offer for 10% off, and let's say it's let's say we're talking about $1,000 average move. So that's like $100. Okay. Well, what would be cool is, Logan, you know those little door security alarms? They're called a Ring through Amazon. They cost about $100. Think of how cool that would be and how fitting it would be for a new homeowner going somewhere that probably doesn't have that built in. It's not a built-in commodity or amenity for most homes. You buy that as a homeowner. Now they're becoming more prevalent, but it's a hot item. What if you said, hey, book a move in qualifying, you know, if it's a $300 move, we're not going to give them $100 ring, you know, ring. So you may want to just put for qualifying,
right?
But how cool would that be? We give them a free ring, or
I'm getting excited over stuff
because it's a good offer.
Well, and it's different.
It's different,
and that's what I like about where you're going with this.
And how many people see their other neighbors with those ring alarms? And so what that actually, it's a very, very unique, very powerful offer because there's a herd mentality with people, and people want, this is why people go and they buy homes that they probably can't afford. They want to be seen from their peers and be accepted. So this item, this commodity is very recognized now. Put that in your offer. It'll work. What are some other ones that I was thinking about earlier? Instead of just giving a cash value offer, what if we did, so they're moving to a new home, What if we said we'll give them a Target voucher to go buy new furniture or new decor?
Ooh.
So instead of, it's the same thing.
What would we give them? What do you think?
You know, I think $25 to $50 is reasonable.
What about a specific item? Like, we'll buy, would that, you think that would be good?
Yeah, it could be specific item. Could be like, what could fit in that price range? I think a lot of decor could fit in there. So maybe it's a new, I mean, I don't know. I think about wall art. Most wall art, you go to like a Target or a Home Goods, most of that stuff fits in that like $50 range or so. This is stuff you just,
it's probably better because it's Target. So there's so much stuff. Now that I'm thinking about it, that's actually probably
the best way to go. Yeah, let people choose. That's the concept of at Christmas time. If you get a gift card, well, if you get a gift card to Kohl's, it's like, well, I can only use it at Kohl's. But if I get you a Visa, like, dude, I can take that wherever I want. The consumer wants where the accessibility. Another really good offer that what was the one that I was looking at earlier? Moving boxes. So people, a lot of times they're like, hey, where can I get free moving boxes? Well, if let's say a medium size, like an 18 by 16 by 16 move box, let's say that you'd sell that at $2 to $3. At your cost, it's probably about 30% of that, 40%. Give them 10 to 20 moving boxes for free. It's just a different offer. It's a cash, for you, it's cash value. But what you can also do is you can print those boxes with your logos, and they're not just getting some random Home Depot box. They're getting a branded item from you.
Gotcha.
So just try to stay
away. That would save them from doing what I do and go into restaurants who just finished inventory, throw all their boxes out, have them sitting out outside.
Right. here's
what about this? This is the one I thought of.
Yeah.
So if I were to move, the biggest thing I would dread the most, I'm good at picking it up, the system of packing it into the moving truck, all that stuff. The part that I hate the most, would dread the most, is packing it. That's like an add-on service, isn't it?
Yeah. So when someone's looking at moving, a lot of times people, they pick this full service option. For most of our move companies, that's just loading, wrapping up the furniture and unloading, but packing is really that add-on upsell. And it's one of your most profitable things you can sell. Because you could do packing jobs every day. It's just not as physically taxing. When you go move large wooden, like oak furniture, like that's taxing on your guys or your movers. And so packing is a better margin. It's better on your people. So you have to play around with the numbers, but what if we make an offer so it's half off full pack? Now the truth is that customers, they're going to pack some of the necessity stuff, and like no matter what, if you come in and do a full pack, they're going to pack some of their stuff. But figure out how you can maybe raise the hourly rate on the moving part once you get into the quoting them, but just make it so that way you could do like 25% or a half off on the pack. You're probably not going to be able to do like free packing just because it'd be too much. But I think you'll catch people's attention with like the 25 or 50% off packing. It's big enough that it's like, that's worth them clicking. That's worth them engaging. And that's what we want. Two more I'll give you real quick. Coming up on holidays. This is right now, you could do this. This is kind of out there, but like, what if you gave somebody a free turkey, you know, a voucher? Now you're not like going and shipping them a turkey. Okay. Figure out how to get a voucher from somebody that sells turkeys and just.
Plenty of stores and restaurants. I just went to a restaurant yesterday.
Yeah.
Where they're doing Thanksgiving turkeys.
Yeah.
It was like, I don't remember. I skimmed it. I saw $35 in there. Something like that.
Yep, a turkey costs usually $25 to $40. So that's a great, like, think about it in dollars. Think about fit in this stuff. And then what about a Christmas tree, like a real Christmas tree? A real Christmas tree in 2019 average costs about $78. Okay. So how cool would that be here in the next couple months if your ad had a voucher to go get a free Christmas tree? And how many people every year are like, man, we should go get a real tree this year that usually have fake trees?
Yeah.
It's just creativity. It's the same thing.
Absolutely.
Same thing as 5% or 10%. It's just different.
Absolutely. You got it. That's good stuff, man. Let's pick one of those. Let's do the moving one, because that was like the one that I'm on. It kind of fits in with my ad copy for our example here. For the we'll pack it for you.
Oh, yeah. Packing. Yep.
Cool. Wouldn't be great if you didn't have to do any of the work.
Yeah.
So it's like, as a matter of fact, you want to make this ad conversational, by the way. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's as you're reading it, people read, if you've read any really good books, the whole thing is, it's not just bullet points everywhere. I'm not saying bullet points are wrong, but the whole book is conversational, right? Because the whole thing flows. And in our minds, we speak that way. It's easy to read and digest, and we'll read more of it because it's engaging, because it's conversational. All right. So as a matter of fact, so I do like to talk as I'm writing this whole thing. So are you about to move? You've probably done this before and can remember how physically and emotionally exhausting it was. Wouldn't it be great if you didn't have to do any of the work? As a matter of fact, we'll even pack all of your stuff for you. Do a little emoji here. We'll do little hearts. And then what's the celebrate thing? Celebrate. Let's do this one. Boom. Right. And then, as a matter of fact, emojis. Let's talk about that real quick.
Okay.
Don't like go crazy with these things, but use them because, again, attention.
Yeah.
The emojis grab attention as people are skimming things.
Either do a house, or you could do a moving truck
or a crying
face. That's emotional. Yeah.
Or the things you said, the moving truck, any of that stuff. As a matter of fact, I just like this cause it's very, people can relate to that.
Relatable. Yeah.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, we'll even pack all of your stuff for you. Urgency and scarcity. I'm about to include these things. These are two of the most motivating things that we can do as marketers, which if you're a business owner, you are a marketer, that we can do as business owners and marketers is urgency, scarcity. So urgency is time related. Scarcity is like a number related. So you want to use these throughout your ad. So as a matter of fact, because people will read this and then they'll sit onto it. And we don't want them doing that. So we need to give them a reason to take action right now.
Yeah.
Right. As a matter of fact, we'll even pack all your stuff for you for a limited time. Mm-hmm. We're offering 30. There's a weird glitch in Facebook where it keeps moving your cursor back up to the top. For a limited time, we're offering 30 lucky movers. Whatever your offer is.
I'm just gonna throw take this out one. Movers. Let's put homeowners, because movers would be, you could get that.
I'm with you.
Guys, right? Yeah.
Good point. 30 lucky homeowners, a 50% off coupon, voucher, whatever word you want to use, whatever word you use, be consistent with it throughout the process. Mm-hmm. So when someone clicks your ad, goes to the next page, mm-hmm. where they would go, you're going to use that same word. That's important. Yeah. Homeowners, a 50% off coupon for us to pack all your things. Is there a name for that?
Like
it's easily recognizable.
I mean, there's not a specific name. I mean, packing. That's just what we reference it.
Pack all your things.
I think.
Or
pack all your house, your household goods. I guess maybe it could be.
Pack your entire house for you.
Yeah.
It's pretty something good. Like that. Okay. And then call to action. Tell them what to do.
Mm-hmm.
Sound good? Click the learn more button below. Learn more, not sign up, not get offer, not any of those things. This is, there's less commitment with learning more. Mm-hmm. More commitment psychologically with the buttons down here. I'll get into that in a second, but we're on it. Get quote, get offer, all those things. There's more commitment there. There's very little with learn more. Our tests have shown learn more does way better than all the other buttons.
Yeah. Just getting information. Yep.
Click the learn more button below to claim your 50% off coupon. Hurry. Only giving out 30 and they. Market is hot.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. I like this.
Yeah.
All right. Headline. So this is the text that we just wrote out. Again, you got three lines to grab someone's attention, or then click that see more button. And it looks like that. Okay. And then you got the image or video, and then you got the headline. Mm-hmm. Headline. This is our best performing headline formula, if you will. So in brackets, all caps, I put whatever the coupon or the length of time is. So 50% off how would I word this? 50% off to move it's a little bit harder with what we're doing here. So, because we're limited on space. So let's do it this way. Pack your entire house for you. How about that?
Yeah, that's solid.
Let's say you read here, you skimmed it. That didn't grab your attention. The image or video didn't get it, but you're the person we're looking for and you're about to move. Mm-hmm. We'll pack your entire house for you. What? That's grabbing my attention because I hate packing things. Yeah. Okay, for moving. Like it? Cool.
Yeah, perfect.
All right. Description. I don't use this a lot, honestly. This goes a little bit below. Let me see if it'll show up. Description. And a lot of times Facebook doesn't even show this. Like right now, it's not showing it. I really just, you can put something here just to emphasize a little bit more. So like 50, so like claim your 50% off coupon now, something like that, just to emphasize the offer or the headline. It goes right below here when Facebook does decide to show it.
Yeah.
Again, most times I don't use it. And website URL, this is just where you want them to go after they click. Make sure whatever your offer is, you are sending them to a page that says what the offer is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So for this, our example before, the offer in the ad was 2 lessons of martial arts for your child for $20. It's not saying they need to know that where they are going or where they are landed on, mm-hmm. they're in the right place. Otherwise, you're going to get a bunch of clicks and then they're going to leave. Okay.
Yeah.
You have to make sure where they land somewhere in text that's very plain in the headline
mm-hmm.
restates the offer. Okay. That's very important. So website, wherever you're sending them. And then I'm just going to call to action, learn more button. And then the rest of this, you are done. And then click publish. Congratulations, we just built out an entire Facebook campaign. I don't know how long we've been doing this, and we talked about a bunch of really good stuff.
Yeah.
How long have we been running? Hour and a half?
Hour and a half. Yeah.
Cool. Not bad.
Not bad. Not bad. So let's talk about, so that landing page you had showed Logan.
Yep.
If, cause some people they're like, they might not know how to even make that. Is that something you guys help custom build for someone?
Yeah, we can. Yes. There's a couple key things. It's not that hard. Mm-hmm. And you can, there's a lot of places you can outsource stuff like that.
Yeah.
And it's not even like, look at this page. This is the most simple page ever. There's a headline of text. There's a couple like little bullet points here that kind of restate what they get in the offer. And then there's a form, and then there's an image or a video and the location of the business. And then we add a little bit of urgency here. You literally is all you need. I know that may sound silly to some people, but that is literally all you need.
Yeah.
Can you do better than that? Yeah. Can you get fancy with it? Yeah. I've gotten fancy before, and I'll tell you, plain and simple doesn't beat fancy.
Mm. Yeah.
And there's tons of software. There's ClickFunnels, there's lead pages, there's Wix, there's all sorts of stuff that'll handle this for you. Mm-hmm. And you can do this in less than an hour.
Yeah. Yeah. If you hear a dog barking, somebody's outside. Okay. Yeah. Simplicity. Yeah. And
keep it simple.
Okay. What is it? Kiss. Keep it simple. Stupid. Yes.
Yep. Keep it simple.
Silly. And it's silly for people that get their feelings hurt. Sorry.
There you go.
Yeah, I think we covered a lot of stuff. I mean, so recommendation here, if you're an owner and you're like, man, this video is like an hour and a half plus, do it in bite sizes. You know, like when you get home, you get done with your work day, like you can spend 20 minutes watching this in chunks over the next couple of days. You can learn a lot of stuff. And, you know, this is part of the game. It's if you want to have this in your marketing arsenal, well, you can either go into it blindly and put a blindfold on your face and try shooting a gun and hit a target, or you could use a scope and use the rifle like we're talking about, use a sniper rifle. So I recommend using a sniper rifle. As long as you know how to pull the trigger, then you're good.
And I'll add on to that too. You know, what we covered was Facebook, but a lot of what we covered too, and maybe it was a little bit hidden into what we were talking about, but a lot of it applies to everything. And it's just marketing. It's thinking about your marketing in general. Who's my audience? Who am I talking to? What's the message to that person specifically?
Yeah.
That's marketing.
Yeah.
On any platform. Doesn't matter where it is. Google ads, anywhere.
Yeah. So, yeah, so true. I think they call that in the MBA people. I think they call that marketing theory or something like that. I don't know.
I was a C student. I didn't get theory. I just went with what gets results.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Well, anything else on the campaign or anything else that is on top of your mind that you want people to know?
No, man, you're a sharp guy. I'd love to do this again with you. Actually, there's so much more. We could get into all sorts of stuff. We could get into retargeting. That'd be great. If people are running ads, like Google ads or something, they're driving traffic to their website.
Yeah.
How cool would it be? Let's say you get 100 clicks right to your website, whether it's organically or you're driving traffic with like Google ads. How cool would it be instead of that relationship ending, right? If they click, they get their information. Maybe they don't fill out a form, so you don't collect their information. They just leave.
Yeah.
Instead of that relationship ending, how about we show them ads on Facebook and Instagram? So everywhere they go, you are on the top of their mind. Yep.
Yeah.
It's like these glasses. I didn't buy these. I think I went to Amazon looking for things to help me so that my eyes don't dry out as I'm looking at a computer screen.
Yeah.
Rating ads and stuff. And so, excuse me. I didn't buy them right away. All of a sudden, everywhere I go, glasses like these are everywhere, right? Yeah. That's retargeting, and it's very simple to do. And it's really powerful. because you know, if they went to your website looking for a moving company, mm-hmm. they were looking for moving.
Yeah.
So who do we want to talk to, right? Where's the low hanging fruit?
Yeah. Well, and it's like the concept. If I go and say I'm looking to buy a car and I go look at a Hyundai Sonata, let's say I don't buy it, but then across town, every time I go out, I'm going to see Hyundai Sonatas. And it's part of our brain that our brain actually is wired to search and find things that have been on file, that have been on the file. Yep. And that's that top of mind marketing that with our service with moving, they might not click right then and there, but it's a timely thing. You know, they list their house, they go under contract, you got 30 days before their move date. And so, yeah, there's a lot of stuff we could go deeper on. If we're going to put this, I'm going to post this up, and then if people have further questions, comment on it.
Is there anyone asking questions live now that has asked questions?
I don't have a chat. We'll have to check back on that. I don't have a chat bar. This is our first Facebook Live, everybody. So this is, we went deep on the tactics here. So, well, Logan, what's the best way for somebody to reach you if they wanted to consider, you know, hey, what would it be like working with you one-on-one? How would somebody find you?
Sure. So actually contact you. And then you can market all day long, but if you don't have the systems and the processes in place, you provide an awesome service helping put the sales and all that. You said it earlier, there's no marketing without sales. It's 100% right. As a matter of fact, I would say get your sales process and all that stuff down first and then market. Otherwise, you're going to spend a lot of money and you're going to waste a lot of money as opposed to if you have your sales process in place, you're just amplifying mm-hmm. that. So I would say maybe we'll do something cool together, you and I, where you do some consulting for the marketing, the moving industry mm-hmm. and helping everybody in the moving industry increase their sales. So and maximize that. So, you know, if maybe I'll just help some of your clients out, maybe like the next 10 or 20 clients, I'll do some consulting and maybe do some work, right alongside of your service.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's awesome. So
reach out to Winston if,
if
you're interested into that.
Yeah. And that's what we're here for. I mean, Logan and I, we're both in the business of helping people. So you have a business and you need help. You need a way to run the business better, more efficiently, more profitable. That's what we do. So, all right, everybody. Well, that's the end of the live stream. We appreciate you. Go crush it. And we will see you when we see you. Peace.
See you.